So this is Defender on the Sega Genesis. Which I'm terrible at. Their bullets really aim well. Which makes this game kind of frustrating. The only way you can really survive a long time is, well, if you make a living playing the game, or if you give yourself, like, a million guys. There's a lot of options, so you can set it up for, you know, like you've got 10 guys to start with or something like that. It's a really spot-on port. I'm guessing by the time the Sega Genesis came around, that console had more memory than the original arcade, so it's a spot-on port. I don't remember if the arcade game was this difficult, though. It might have been. It's just that we really got into it, I guess. But man, yeah, those bullets, whoa. See, those really good shots. Which, you know, makes the game a challenge. It's so fun. So there's the Defender for the Sega Genesis. Let's take a look at the ColecoVision Defender. See if I can get a couple mutants here. Oh god, yeah, these guys. Angry little bastards. Okay. That's good, that's good. I love how Atari just, like, boasts its own logo, like, way bigger than Williams, or, like, this is our game now. It was made by Williams, not Atari. I'm just smart bombing. So here's the ColecoVision Defender, which is a really good version. The ship is a little clunkier than the Sega or the arcade. It's still pretty good. It moves up and down nicely, but doesn't go forward or doesn't go in the horizontal direction very rapidly. That's as fast as it goes. That's it. So that's kind of frustrating. It's a little slow. But it's a very good port, considering ColecoVision was, you know, came out pretty much around the time the arcade version was still around, very much in force, you know. This was like 83, I think Defender came about in like 81, you know, so for an 8-bit system, it was pretty cool to have this in your house, you know, with this quality. That's why ColecoVision was a huge hit, it just was short-lived. Very good version. The enemy's exploding sound is kind of disappointing. It sounds like a little fart. And I found those things are really important. You know, it gives you that sense of gratification when you blow something up to have a nice explosion sound. Now, your explosion sound is great. So there's the ColecoVision Defender. And here's the Atari 2600. You notice I went right through that enemy. If you hit the fire button, your spaceship disappears. See that? And you can go through stuff, and bullets won't hurt you. They'll go right through you. So there's a fun glitch about this game. The Atari 2600 obviously is a pretty limited system, but they had their great moments, and this really wasn't one of them, but this is actually a fun Defender. I'm not sure how I just died there. It doesn't go up and down very fast at all. That's as fast as the ship goes up and down, which is kind of frustrating. But it does move forward. It scrolls nicely, much faster than the ColecoVision one, actually. Oh, Let's see if I can get that guy. Ah, I think he died. But, yeah, the Atari one, not bad. Nice little plume coming out the back of the ship there. You can actually play the game for a while without going crazy or getting too angry. It's fun. Oh, he just zapped something. That's pretty weird. Smart Bomb, you gotta go to the top of the screen. And, wait till we have some folks here. That's your Smart Bomb. So you gotta go to the top of the screen, which isn't really too convenient, but it was all they could really come up with, I guess. Because they only got one button on the Atari. So, there's the Atari. Now let's look at the Odyssey 2 Defender. Freedom Fighters! For the Philips Odyssey, or the Magnavox Odyssey 2, or the Video Pack, or the Philips G7000. Take your pick. It's all the same system! The greatest system in the world! I'm gonna sound like one of those old commercials. So, here is, you know, as you guys know, Odyssey was very late in the game to do the third-party licensing. And my theory is, since they were owned by Philips, one of the largest electronics technology manufacturers to date in the world, the big boys tend to think differently than the smaller ones. And the smaller ones really were Atari and Mattel and Coleco. Philips is huge. They were thinking outside the box and being very smart. They said, licensing, we'll just make our own copies of everything and call them something else, you know. And so they would have Ed Averett, you know, go at it and make games that were just like the other ones until they got their pants suit off over Casey Munchkin, and that changed the game. But that didn't happen until 81, and they still kept doing this, but then they finally went into licensing, which was much hipper and trendier to actually have the title on your system, you know. But that was my theory anyways, that Philips was like, we don't need to play that game, we're too big. But, and they didn't really care about this system at all. They were ready to let it go every month, according to Ed Averett. He said he'd put a game out, and then they'd say, okay, hold on, this one's selling. But they were ready to drop Odyssey from, like, day one, which is pretty sad. But nevertheless, it was a great system, and thanks to guys like Ed Averett, they made some great games for it. And so, getting back to the game, you can also pick up the other controller and play what I call like an Asteroids version, where you don't scroll, you just zoom around the screen. You've got rapid fire, which the other defenders don't have. And Odyssey has the insane advantage of, I think, the best controller ever made. This joystick moves with such accuracy. You've got the notched positioning so you know exactly when you're going diagonal. Ever tried to play Q-Bert on the ColecoVision with the original controllers? Horrible experience. Moving diagonal is not a challenge with the Odyssey 2. The joystick just maneuvers perfectly. If I had to fly a spaceship in real life, I would want an Odyssey 2 controller for it. You got guys to rescue. It's very Defender-like, you know. And the explosions are great. Look at the epic explosions. And you can just take flight, grab the other controller, and die. No, but it's great with two people to play. One guy controlling the one type of navigation and one doing the other. You can park yourself at the far end of the screen, too, and get more of a more foresight as to what's going on. But the movement of the spaceship is very fast, as you can see. You got your rapid fire. You can score guys like that. And it gets difficult in a very swift sort of way. Once you hit around 100 points, it becomes insanely fast. which keeps me coming back to this game. I've never been able to get beyond about 300 points, maybe 350. But absolutely love Odyssey's Freedom Fighters. And I think in many ways, it is the most fun of these Defender-like games. It's got super simple graphics, but they're really good. I mean, I like the spaceship, the little plume coming out the back. The way it turns around is really cool. Notice it turns green when you're doing the scrolling version. And when you stop, it turns blue. If I can stop. And moving forward is really cool. Whenever you go up and down, it starts moving forward. So it's a very effortless... This is like the sports car of spaceships. See how much faster it's going now. So, Odyssey 2 always took the hit of being like the simplest, dumbest system of the day. But, I mean, these games, when my buddies would come over, we would be roaring on the floor, laughing, having so much fun with these games. But it's brutal, man. It's like typical Odyssey 2. You get one guy and you die. It's a man's game. Even if you were a 9-year-old girl, if you played Odyssey 2, you were a man. One guy, you die. So Odyssey just rewrote the rule book. So there you go.